بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على الأنبياء المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا وانفعنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين. My dear respected brothers and elders and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So, today is the last day of the first 10 nights of Ramadan, I guess you would say. So we are entering into the next 10 days, which is the 10 days of forgiveness, or 10 nights of forgiveness. And so, mashallah, what we should try our best to do is do more istighfar and recognize our faults. Again, Ramadan is a time of self-reflection and introspection. We're supposed to take this time to really reflect on ourselves and see where we're lacking in terms of belief in Islam. And the fasting is showing us that throughout the day, we can be dedicated to Allah. We can listen to His commands, okay? And Allah made us avoid that thing which we needed the most, which we thought we needed the most, which was food and drink. And so we can see that, alhamdulillah, we have a lot of capability, a lot of potential in ourselves. Now it's for us, inshallah, to take the lead and make every single day after Ramadan like Ramadan, inshallah ta'ala. So having said that, mashallah, I wanted to kind of wrap up these last 10 days with a really nice surah, a really nice story within Surah Al-A'raf. It's not a well-known story, and so you might learn something new today because of just the story itself. I felt like majority of the stories that we go over in the Quran, people are like, oh, I already know that story. But my goal is not just to take out the story parts, to take out the lessons too. Because what's the point of hearing the story if we're just like, oh, wow, that was nice, and also entertainment. The Quran is not a book for entertainment, although it is entertaining and enjoyable. But the goal of the Quran is that we actually take some lessons behind it. We actually take something from it, inshallah. Okay? So having said that, mashallah, we want to really study this story, which is the man who was given signs. That's how he's called in the Quran. Okay? So we have been discussing throughout these last 10 days. And inshallah, tomorrow will be Surah Yusuf. If people are like, oh, man, I want to hear Surah Yusuf. Inshallah, tomorrow we'll be doing one more part of Surah Yusuf. And I think the last part will be on Saturday. Because we have other people listening in and stuff. So they're probably looking forward to those parts too. So I just don't want to make people miss out, you know? Having said that, mashallah, may Allah reward everyone that's listening, and I hope that we are all benefiting. And I, mashallah, I'm enjoying it just because I just love looking at the Quran, and this gives me, you know, an excuse and an opportunity to really look into the Quran and pull out many things for myself and for everyone here, inshallah. Okay, so we have been discussing from the beginning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has elevated human beings because of their knowledge. We saw that through Adam alayhi salam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had elevated him because of the fact that Allah ta'ala taught him. Okay. And because of that, he becomes on a higher level than angels. So through knowledge and understanding, we find ourselves to be elevated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. And so the second thing that we talked about throughout these last 10 days was the idea of having respect. Okay. So when Iblis did not respect Adam alayhi salam, he was degraded. When he did not respect Allah's commands, he was degraded. When we saw that the questioning of the companions of Isa alayhi salam was quote unquote, it looked a little disrespectful. You know, they had to make sure to clarify and make sure that was made clear to Isa alayhi salam that they weren't trying to disrespect him. So we're learning that we have to be careful about the way we speak, right? And so we have to have a lot of adab and respect for those above us in deen. And then the last thing that we talked about, which was through Yusuf alayhi salam's story, was the dangers of the sicknesses of the heart. We saw that because of jealousy, what it led to was the brothers being disgraced or mocked or shamed in front of everyone, okay? And that's going to happen to every single one of our sicknesses if we're not able to deal with them. Either in this world, Allah Ta'ala will expose the sickness, which is a ni'mah from Him in reality. If we can't get it treated, you know, with the primary or secondary care, sometimes the tertiary option, the third option would be just to cut the arm off, right? To get rid of it right here. And so sometimes Allah Ta'ala will expose us in this world so that we're saved from the punishment of the hereafter, which is actually much better if you're thinking about it, really thinking about it. It's better than going through Jahannam. May Allah save us and protect us from that, inshallah ta'ala. But having said that, it's important to recognize that sometimes the sickness of the heart will come out in this world, and it will come out in a very dangerous or very, very disgusting way. Okay. It is the worst type of sickness that you can ever imagine, which is the sicknesses of the heart. They're so filthy. And when people see them, they just run away from them. Okay. So now this story will capture these amazing themes. And the surah itself is Surah Al-A'raf. Surah Al-A'raf, mashallah, has a lot of different topics. If I were to like summarize in like two words, it would probably be like Surah Al-A'raf talks about humanity, okay, and signposts. Okay. Surah Al-A'raf talks about humanity. And signposts, araf, meaning arafa, those things that you recognize. It's literally talking about those people who are on the heights on the day of judgment, they're going to see Jannah and Jahannam, and they give you like a really nice aerial, a bird's eye view of Jannah and Jahannam. They tell you about things about the people inside. They have a really interesting perspective, which we're not going to really get to talk about. We'll see inshallah maybe another day. But the point of the surah though, because Arafah also means to recognize, right? So Allah Ta'ala throughout the surah is just saying that I sent guidance upon guidance upon guidance to people, and they have the option of taking it. And if they want to take it, they can embrace their humanity, okay? And if they don't want to embrace their humanity, they want to really take in their humanity, they just drop to the level of animals, and even worse than animals. And this entire surah, mashallah, will capture all of those themes together, okay? So without further ado, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ الَّذِي آتَيْنَاهُ آيَاتِنَا فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ. I'm not going to go and reflect on who it is in the beginning. We're going to talk about who it is at the end, okay? Because we don't want to miss what Allah is actually telling us. وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ الَّذِي آتَيْنَاهُ آيَاتِنَا. Recite on them the story, the naba, the amazing, the wonderful, the enormous news of the one who we gave our signs to. فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا. And so Mutitaq Ismail have translated as he wriggled out from them. I'm going to translate it as he slithered out of them. Okay? He slithered away from them. فَأَتْبَعْهُ الشَّيْطَانِ. So Shaytan followed him, pursued him. فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ. So he became one of the perverted, meaning one of the ignorant, the foolish ones. Okay? So let's go through, inshallah, some of the points of this ayah. It's only about three ayat. Okay, in this one ayah though, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing a person. He describes them in 1, 2, 3, 4 different qualities. So we want to go through each one of them. When you hear the word naba in the Quran, by the way, remember that naba does not mean a small story. Naba is a ginormous news, okay? So for example, a small story would be like, you know, a cat was stuck on a tree and like the firefighter went up, mashallah, and he saved the cat, okay? Not saying cat lives are not, they don't matter. Cat lives matter, of course. But the point is just like, it's not something that really bothers you, right? Whereas naba would be like, there's a tornado outside, you know? So the scale of the cat being stuck on the tree versus the tornado, which makes you move, right? You can see the difference in between. Same way when Allah Ta'ala says the word naba, when you hear the word naba in the Quran, you think of Nabi. A Nabi came to tell you like crazy, like ajeeb things, you know, to make sure that you get up and do things with your life. So that's what Allah Ta'ala is saying here too, is that recite on them the naba. Tell them the huge, amazing, wonderful, extraordinary story of this person who we gave our signs to, okay? So Allah Ta'ala first says, number one, the first quality this guy had was that we gave him ayat, we gave him signs. Okay, so now he has a certain level, a capacity of understanding deen. And Allah Ta'ala said we gifted it to him. The word atayna is showing that Allah Ta'ala gave it very easily. Very easily Allah Ta'ala gave it to him. He understands deen, he values deen, he appreciates deen. Everything of deen, of Islam, all the signs of Allah Ta'ala, he takes it. And these are signs, okay? Now what are signs? When we think about a sign is something that directs you where you need to go. Like you see like a sign to like, you know, you're taking the Route 3 to like Waltham or whatever, right? You're going this way to Boston, whatever, right? A sign directs you to where you need to go. And you trust the sign, right? You trust the sign. The sign is what? It's going to lead you without even having to be in front of you. That's the beauty of having a sign. It will. You saw the message on it and you're like, okay, I just got to go this way and I'm good to go. And alhamdulillah, we thank Allah that these signs work the right way, right? You know what to do. And certain signs are like what? They're stop signs because they save you from danger. And certain signs are like what? They are the green light, which lets you go because you know now it's safe to continue, right? So you're having these signs that are helping you in life all the time, okay? So that's why Allah Ta'ala, He calls the Quran signs. Because what do signs do for us? They guide us. They tell us what to do without always having to be in front of our eyes, telling us exactly which way to go and which way to live life. Okay, so the GPS is like a very good example of a modern sign. Okay, what does the GPS do? It gives you all the directions, so you know without even you can put in your from Massachusetts to New York, and it'll map out the route for you. Right, you'll know exactly which way to go, which is really extraordinary. And one of the most interesting parts of the GPS is this, is that it will, if you start to go off into a wrong way, you'll hear redirecting and the GPS will actively redirect you, okay? And I find this to be a very good example of what the Quran does for you too, okay? Is that when we are going off on the wrong way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made these signs, ayat translates to signs, right? Allah subhanahu made these ayat that they redirect you towards the right way. Okay, so what happens is what? In life, we end up taking this way or that way. What Allah Ta'ala does through the Quran is that He makes sure you get back on track. Okay, He makes sure you get back on track. So that's what these signs do, because the Quran is a living book. it lives with you. It breathes with you. Like it experiences your life the same way you're experiencing the Quran. One of the most amazing things about the Quran is this, is that when you go and you try to get some guidance from it, it actually directs you to the signs. Now we just have to be attentive and look at the sign. Now imagine someone went by the sign that told them to take like, you know, a left at this place so they can get to Waltham, right? And then they end up screwing up and they end up getting like nowhere. They have no idea where they are. That's their fault for not looking at the sign. So Allah is just telling us to look at these signs from Him, right? So the only way, if we're talking about the GPS, the only way to not be guided by the GPS is to be like the dad. What are we talking about? The dad looks at the GPS. And because men are like this, right? They don't like to take directions from anyone. You tell them what to do, they don't want to listen to you, right? And I'm not saying this is a man exclusive problem. But I'm just saying that I just saw this be very, very common as well. Is that when the GPS is telling them to go this way, they're like, nah, I know better than the GPS. Right. And then what happens is what? They take like a left turn and then they end up going like to the middle of like Albuquerque or like Kentucky or whatever. And they're like, what the heck are we? There's no fried chicken here. You know, like they get randomly lost in random places. Right. And so because of why? Because we think we know better than GPS. Now, admittedly so, I'm not saying this because mashallah, some of you guys are really good with this stuff, is that some of you might be better than the GPS. That's true. But you cannot do that with the Quran. You cannot do that with the Quran. It's virtually impossible to say, I know better than the Quran, okay? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designed us, and He designed our lives, and He gave us the Quran as an instruction manual to live our lives. For us to say that we know better than the Quran is to say we know better than our Creator, because He's the one who gave us our manual, okay? So that's why are we mentioning this? Because it's very, very important that people, sometimes they feel like they can be more guided than the Quran, but that's only because of ignorance and arrogance. I don't want to follow the Quran. I don't want to follow its rules on riba. I don't want to follow its rules on nikah. I don't want to follow these rules. I don't want to. That's because you're arrogant. That's not, you know, Allah to save us. I'm not saying anyone here, of course. I'm talking to myself. It's our arrogance that we think that we don't need it or we don't whatever. Okay? The Quran literally says in the Quran, it says itself, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرَانِ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ. Okay? That's in Suratul Isra. Allah Ta'ala says that surely this Quran guides to that which is the most correct. You cannot get more correct than the Quran. You cannot find the most accurate way to live life other than within this book, okay? So now, this is what Allah there first explains, that we gave Him our signs. And the reason why I'm mentioning all these small little points in the middle, because I don't want anyone to think that Allah is just specifying one guy. He's talking to all of us right now. He's talking to all of us. So Allah there gave us all of these signs. And He gave us His Quran. And He gave us His deen. So He slithered away from them. فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا. He slithered. In silakh, it means to shed a skin, to take off a skin. So it's slithering away from something, right? It's slipping away. What does this reveal about this person? Is that number one is that Allah Ta'ala gave them their signs, but they didn't really want it. And they don't want people to know that they don't want it. So what do? They start to, without people noticing, they'll stop following the signs of Allah Ta'ala, they'll stop following the deen. So in other words, all right, I outside in front of people, I'll show them that I'm a great Muslim. I will give the sadaqah. I will come for salah. I will do these things. But when I'm at home, yeah, I know I make sunnah in front of everyone in the first row, in the first saf. When I'm at home, I don't really want to, right? Or like, you know, I know I wear hijab within masjid, but like outside masjid, come on, we really need to do that. You know, so we follow in front of people and we are given the signs, but then when we're by ourselves, we don't want to follow the signs anymore. Oh yeah, I tell people about the tahajjud all the time, but you know, in reality, I don't really pray it. You know, like Allah Ta'ala protect us. Like we're talking in front of people big, but when we're not with people, that's when our real character comes out. What's actually underneath the skin. So we make the choice. So point one was what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said about us that we will, without people noticing, we will not follow the signs. Second thing is that what? You're noticing He made the choice. No one forced Him to do it. He decided on this on His own. He just wanted to not follow the signs anymore. So we are making the choice here. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to everyone, like I just mentioned, because everyone is given chances to follow the truth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so kind though. Like the GPS, He makes sure to give us another sign while we're going off track. Allah will give us a sign. And I find this to be the case with husband and wife all the time. When they get into an argument, a heated argument, right? And then the feeling in the heart will come, you know what, maybe I should just say sorry and I should just, you know, ask for forgiveness. I mean, it's not going to hurt. It's not going to hurt, right? It's not like I lost like a war or whatever. I just apologize. It's not the biggest, you know, whatever. The Prophet ﷺ said in a beautiful hadith, authentic hadith, that a person who gives up an argument, even though they're in the truth, even though they're right, okay? They'll be given a house in the middle of Jannah. Subhanallah. So mashallah, you and I just by, you know, because I think every husband and every wife thinks they're right. I don't think anyone thinks they're wrong. All right, I'll just drop the argument for what? For the fact that I want a nice middle house in Jannah. You know, I'd like to have a nice place in the Bahamas, right? Whatever. Mashallah, you can have a nice middle place in Jannah. Allahu Akbar.
Okay? So we have the opportunity, but then what happens is what? We get really arrogant with it. We don't want to. So now you and I probably thought this when we heard slithering. We thought of what kind of animal? We thought of a snake. And Allah Ta'ala is highlighting the reality of this human being. He's not a human. He's not a human. Allah, and Allah Ta'ala can say it. I can't say it about people. We shouldn't say it about people. But Allah Ta'ala can say it because He's the creator of us and He knows us. And He's like, look, I gave him a human skin. I gave him human flesh. I gave him a human heart. I gave him a human mind. I gave him human eyes and ears. I gave him everything as a human. But he's a snake in human skin. He doesn't want to be a human. He does not want to be a human. Because why? Because people want to abandon the humanity. How is that so? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the surah, I love it so much. Really, the surah, Surah Al-A'raf, people need to read it, mashallah, and really think about it. In the surah, Allah that describes human and jinns that become worse than animals. Right? There's an ayah in Surah Al-A'raf, أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمَ ضَلْ. Allah that says they're like animals, they're like cattle, but they're even more misguided than cattle. They're even more misguided than animals. And why is that the case? Because why? Because at least, I'm not going to here to offend anyone, but like, you know, a cow would understand, at least a male and female cow will come together and make like small little calves, right? They'll make small little babies. Human beings are only such human only creatures in the world that will consider for themselves that the way to make sure our species will survive is that a man needs to be with a man. You know, like it's like ajib, like this type of human, like this type of creature, this type of species would drop a bomb on itself, right? Will kill its own people, its own type of species, because why? Because they thought that one human is greater than another human. You'll never find that within animals. Animals at least will respect each other to some degree, some capacity. They won't ever try to kill each other or like create a genocide, right? You never see like a genocide like of a cow going World War III on like other cows, right? That doesn't happen, right? So, you know, he doesn't make like, you know, ground beef of every other cow, right? So that's the thing here, is that human beings actually are worse than animals in many times. They don't use their eyes, their brains, or their ears to find the truth. That's what Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran. He says, how did they become worse than animals? Because they stopped using their eyes, they stopped using their ears, and they stopped using their brains. They think they are the greatest creatures on this world, and they can do whatever they want because they are masters of this world. That's not the way Allah made us. He made us as servants, as people to take care of the world, not for the world to take care of us. It's two different things, right? That Allah made us in this world so we can take care of the animals and the plants and the entire civilization, not for everything to serve us, okay? So now they chose a lower lifestyle than what humans are granted. And where is that found? Choosing a lower lifestyle. The story begins in the surah, and I love it. SubhanAllah, like I tell you, like the Quran is just so well connected. Adam alayhi salam, Iblis's story is mentioned in the beginning of the surah. And you're like, Sheikh, but how is that connected to what we're talking about now? Because Iblis's one goal in the surah, if you're looking at the goal of him with Adam alayhi salam, whatever, is that he just wanted Adam alayhi salam to lose his clothing. And you're like, what does that have to do with being human? Well, I'm telling you that Allah is telling us in the surah that the clothing that you and I wear is a sign of our humanity, okay? That Iblis wanted to take away Adam alayhi salam's humanity by taking away his clothes. So Allah reminds us of the blessing of clothing in the beginning of the surah, that this is what makes us human. So when Muslims go out with a topi, or they're having their beard, or wearing a hijab, don't feel embarrassed, okay? Don't feel embarrassed. When people are naked and someone's walking around with clothes, the person who's wearing clothes should not feel embarrassed, okay? The people who are feeling naked should feel a little ashamed. But the thing is that what? We're around animals. So do animals care if they're naked or not? No. I mean, like, look at this, the shameless monkey. He's literally jumping around with all of his monkey parts, like, all over the place, right? It's just totally gross. But look at the, that's really funny, Sheikh. Yeah, but look at these human beings at the beach and stuff like that. They're straight up naked and they don't even care. And then, I'm being weird because what? No, because Allah created us with a purpose. And our purpose is what? That we remain clothed, like people like Jannah. So people should never feel embarrassed that I'm feeling clothed. La ilaha illallah, or I'm wearing clothes. This is our lifestyle choice, and be very, very be proud of it, alhamdulillah. Allah that gave us Islam, Allah that gave us his deen, okay? So now, this is the second part Allah that mentions about him. Number one is that Allah gave him signs. He doesn't want to follow the signs, so he dropped them. He slithered away, he became a snake. The third thing is what? So because he actively chose to become someone who doesn't follow the signs of Allah, Allah that said, Shaitan began to lead him, okay? So now this guy we're talking about, Shaitan decides to misguide this person. Okay. Shaitan decides to misguide this person. So Shaitan begins to hunt this person down. So now what we're learning here is that when we take the first step towards Shaitan, Shaitan actually is the one who takes the next couple of steps towards us. So we are actually the first ones to make the initiative. We go in and then he follows us. Right? So now he is going to do what? We're taking the GPS example. Now the guy abandoned the GPS. He's like, I don't want to follow it. He's in an unknown area. He's like, I don't want to follow the GPS. I'm going to use my instincts. Dad has a gut feeling, you know? The father has a gut feeling. So he says, you know what? I'm just going to go off the main road and I know exactly where I'm going. And then the wife and the kids are in the back like, Dad, please. don't be a dad right now. Just follow the GPS, right? He's like, no, I know the way. And so in this unknown life, right, we do that too. We say, nah, forget it. I don't want Allah Ta'ala's guidance. What does Allah know, right? I can figure it out myself. Clearly, this is the best option right now. I need to do the riba. I need to do this. I need to do this. I can't, praying this 2 rakats is not going to help me right now. I need to be doing this instead. You know, so we make these choices, but we forget that life is very unknown. Okay, you're making a decision without any navigation. That's your choice. I'm not forcing anyone here. But think about it. Think about it again, logically and scientifically speaking. You are one. In terms of an experiment, your sample size is one. You're experiencing life for the first time, right? You haven't lived like 10, 20, 30, 50, 70,000 lives. You don't know what is best for you. Okay? You might think you know what's best for you because of small information that we received, but that's just small information. Who has all the information? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does. For you to say, I know more than him is literally just like, it's just being crazy. It's like, again, remember the ant example? The ant is yelling back at the human saying, what are you talking about? Geometry is like this. I know geometry better than you. The ant is saying that to the human. That's probably a nicer example than you and I yelling at Allah saying, Allah, I know better than you. I don't want to follow this. So now going off, what happens is what? Shaitan is going to start taking the wheel. He's like, hey, bro, I know exactly where you need to go. Follow me. And he'll take you to a place that looks like Disneyland. But it's a very, very dark path that actually looks beautiful, but has a really dark end at the final part. So Shaitan's goal is not to take you to a place where like it looks like terrible, like, you know, like those trees that like are like looking like they're about to grab you or whatever. He's going to take you to a path that looks like Disneyland. He's going to take you to a path where it looks like it's Disney World. He's going to take you to a path where it's like Universal Studios. He's going to take you to this beautiful, amazing area, but he doesn't show you what's at the end. So he's just like, yeah, just go down this way. You'll be completely fine. So you go and follow Shaitan, but at the end of the path, it's extremely dark and bleak. And you're like, where am I? And at the end, we realize at this life that we followed our own desires and we ended up in the fire. Allah to save us from that. Or we ended up on the Day of Judgment that we're not on the right side. We're like, what happened? I thought I was doing everything right. But Shaitan decided to take the wheel and take us to a very dark end. We ask Allah for protection here. Now, Shaitan is one interpretation was that Shaitan follows him, you know, began to follow him. I want to give you one other interpretation, which is what atba'a. The word atba'a in Arabic can also mean when you are taking someone as your imam sub, right? Like, you know, you're a muqtadi, you have a muqtada, right? In Arabic, you have a muqtadi, someone who follows the imam, and the salah is called muqtadi, and someone who is followed is called muqtada, right? Or muqtadabi, right? And so the same thing that you can be a tabi'a, you can be a follower, or you can be matbu'a, you can be a followed person, okay? So the word atba'a has this meaning that when you want to take someone to follow, or you want to make someone your imam sub, so Shaitan made him an imam, okay? That's what we're getting at this point. Shaitan made this guy imam sub. He said, you know what? You are the guy I need. You are the right guy for the job. You will be the one to misguide everyone. I can sit down on my chair, on my throne, on top of whatever water it's on top of. And he said, you know what? You'll be the imam. You'll misguide the people. So now Shaitan says, congratulations. You just graduated from, congratulations. You get the university, you graduated from the University of Shaitan. Here is your PhD in misguiding people. And this is your PhD in devilishness, right? You become the devil. Go ahead. Now misguide people, okay? So now this is what happens to this guy here. So number one, what we find is that he was given signs from Allah. Number two was that he decided to slip away from all of them. Number three is Shaitan started to follow him or made him the imam sub. And number four, and this is what happens, by the way, people be very careful that I think we all have like a family member that's like this, that they're like quote unquote very Muslim, right? But then like they talk like all this weird garbar, like nonsense stuff. Like, yeah, Hajj is not really necessary. Like you can just feed the poor and stuff like that. Like they speak some weird stuff, right? And so when they step off, what happens is what? They become a source of misguidance for others, right? Like there's that one cousin that you know that's like, man, he's like super atheist. And then he starts to like put this waswasa in other people's brains, right? So they become a source of misguidance for other people. This is Shaitan literally making the imam because he's like, I don't need to be there. I'll send you in there. You can take care of them. You be the Shaitan. That's no problem. Right? Not all shayateen are locked up in Ramadan, by the way. Some of them are still out there, right? So now Allah Ta'ala says the final thing about him, quality number four is فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ. He became one of the foolish people, one of the ignorant people. Okay? And it literally means that person who fell off. The word غاوي means someone who fell off the way. Allah Ta'ala is saying that he was on the path. He went way off the path. Like we were talking about like the GPS here. So now this foolishness, the word in Arabic, which is غاي, which I found really funny to write out in English. I think everyone can kind of laugh at it looking at it. I'm like, yeah, it's a funny word. Like Allah Ta'ala knows. Okay, so the ghai here, those people who are really ghai, are someone who is ignorant, who based off of false ideas. In Arabic, the word means someone who is really he's a jahil, but not a jahil because like, oh, he's a Muslim and he's following Islam and he's trying his best. He doesn't know a lot of things. So you could say he's quote unquote jahil, but he's still a good person, you know? But this is someone who has wrong ideas and they follow them. You know, like, I don't want to start calling out certain conspiracy theories, but you know, you ever met a conspiracy theorist and be like, bro, man, you're just talking, you're an idiot and you're talking idiot stuff. Like, I just don't like what you're saying. Like, please stop talking like that, right? So you feel like you're talking to a person who doesn't know anything. I don't want to say like a flat earther, but you get my drift here, right? You just get like this feeling like this guy doesn't seem to understand any common sense or anything at all, okay? So now this person's life becomes absolutely miserable. Now, I'm going to say like, in terms of conspiracy theory, the spectrum, the lower level would be like, okay, flat earthers and these people that say this doesn't exist and the moon landing didn't happen, whatever. Those are like lower level conspiracies. The other one is like what? Like the NSA is following me, the FBI is following me, the CIA is tracking me and stuff like that. Those are people who are really off. The life becomes super miserable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this person at the end, the goal, the result of all this stuff happening is what? This person's life becomes a total wreck. Their children don't follow Islam. The children don't listen to them. The wife hates them. Everything is wrong with this person. And he doesn't seem to realize it. That's the worst part. That's the saddest part for you and I looking from the outsider perspective. May Allah save us from being this person. But when we look at a guy who's been totally deceived by shaitan, we look at him like, bro, man, you had everything. You had deen. What happened now? Like, you know, your wife left you, your kids left you, everything. You got a divorce. Everything just got ruined, you know? Life becomes miserable for this person, okay? And so this will be example. If we're talking about the car example, the kids will say, dad, we've been on the road for hours. And the dad will still say, I know where I'm going. Don't argue with me. Right, and so this is what happens: the stubbornness. I don't accept that I fell off the path. So now these are the four things Allah Ta'ala says about this person, the qualities that he has. وَلَوْ شِئْنَا لَرَفَعْنَاهُ بِهَا. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says, if we so willed, we would have elevated him thereby. But he clung onto the earth and followed his desires. So example is like the example of a dog. If you attack him, he pants with his tongue protruding, and if you leave him alone, he still pants with his tongue protruding. That is example of those who rejected our signs. So relate the story so that they may ponder. Okay. Now let's talk about this part, inshallah ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says first and foremost that we wanted to raise him. Okay. Allah ta'ala said that I wanted to raise him. I gave you the signs. Why did Allah ta'ala give us the deen? You know, I can ask everyone here, right? Why did Allah ta'ala give us the deen? He gave us the deen because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be elevated. That's the reason. I know it sounds really strange because you're like, what? Life gets a little difficult. Yeah, obviously, because this life wasn't the purpose. This life is a testing room. What do you thought? The exam room was supposed to be enjoyable? Like, who the heck brings a sofa into an exam hall? You're supposed to be in there to take an exam, you know? So take the exam and get done with the exam. So that's the thing. Life is an exam. I know it's hard for people to accept it because we like it so much. We enjoy it so much. But this is really the exam hall. Don't lose track of sight of that goal that I need to pass this exam. So Allah gave us signs to lead us in this world. He's the king. He wants us to be connected to him. That at the end of this exam is what? The king's banquet. It is Jannah. Allah wants us to get through this life and go to him. He wants to raise us. So he gave us this knowledge. He gave us his deen for all this raising. But sometimes the path is a little difficult, and admittedly so. I won't lie. You know, sometimes life is a little challenging because I expect that from a test. A test should be a little challenging. If it's a good test, it'll challenge you a little bit, you know? But those honored to go to the king must be great people. I mean, alhamdulillah, if Allah chose us to give us signs, then we should think that, alhamdulillah, we're very honored. The creator of the heavens and the earth, the maker of the heavens and the earth, is saying, you know what? I'm going to give you my Quran. Here's my Islam for you. Allah gave it to us on a silver platter. We should be honored. We should really feel honored, mashallah. And so what we have to remember is that this path, though, because Allah is such a noble king, is this path will, in effect, train us to get to Allah Ta'ala. This life is a training. It's life is a test. This path is a test for us. That's all it is. So remember that whatever you're going through in life, whatever difficulties, you will come out stronger at the end, with the stronger will, with better endurance, you become a stronger person, but you just need to survive, inshallah. So what happens is what? This life will ultimately be a training for us to enter the gardens of Jannah. That's what Allah Ta'ala wants. That's what he's saying about this person here. I just want him to enter Jannah. But what he wanted was what? He wanted to remain here forever. وَتَّبَعْهَوَى. So the word that was used here, okay? The word that was used here was, وَلَكِنَّوْ أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ, right? The word أَخْلَدَ means someone who decides to be خَالِد, right? Someone wants to be there forever. So he doesn't want to leave the test room. He doesn't want to leave the exam hall. So he decided to live here forever. So he wanted to follow his desires. So Allah says that's what his choice was. So then his example is like the example of the dog, okay? Allah SWT doesn't say his example is the dog. Allah said it's like the dog. And that's really important to keep in mind. Because we're not dissing dogs here. I know that Muslims probably don't know nothing about dogs. And I admittedly so I had to study a little bit about dogs to get an idea about what Allah was trying to tell me here, okay? And it's not like a cat, it's unlike a cat, okay? How so? So dogs have unconditional love. So what are we saying here? The dogs have good qualities. And because you're Hanafi, not gonna really know anything about the qualities of dogs. You know, if you want to switch to Maliki Madhav, maybe we can talk about that later. It's just a joke, okay? But dogs will have unconditional love for their masters. They always support their masters. They're really good with that. They're happy with themselves. You notice a dog, he can be happy with whatever you give him. You give him a bone, he's happy. You give him a full meal, he's happy. He's always happy whatever they have, right? And yeah, they're very simple, right? They can live with basically nothing. And that's how they are, right? And they are selfless in the sense that they always sacrifice for their master. You see like dogs that are in the, like desert dogs and dogs that work for shepherds and stuff. They do so many things and they just, you know, they'll do it all day dedicatedly. And then at the end of the day, they'll just get their small meal and they'll be completely fine with that. You know, one scholar, he wrote it's like the 10 different qualities that you and I need to be like a dog. He said, because a dog has so many good qualities. Okay. So, and the most important part about a dog is what? It's loyal. And why am I mentioning this in spite of the cat? Because I've lived with cats for a good portion of my life. I'm telling you, cats, they can't wait till you die. You know, cats are really, really mean type of creatures. Right? They don't have anything like a dog does. A dog has all these good qualities. So I'm only mentioning that because Allah says it's like a dog, not a dog. And so why is it that Allah compares it to a dog? Because dogs have a certain quality Allah wanted to highlight, which is the fact that a dog cannot rest. I mean, literally cannot rest. Because dogs pant to regulate their temperature. So if if you're seeing a dog panting, right, it's breathing in like, because that's what dogs do, right? They just start breathing in really hard. If you're seeing a dog doing that, it's doing that to regulate its temperature. It doesn't sweat. It doesn't sweat like human beings. It has small little sweat like pores here and there. But in reality, a dog needs to breathe out, needs to pant in very heavily to make sure it regulates its temperature. What happens if it stops doing that? It's going to overheat. What happens if it overheats? It's going to die. Okay. So a dog needs to keep doing it. And so if you're seeing a dog panting all the time, because probably here and there you see a dog start to breathe in heavily. But if you're seeing a dog pant all the time, then that's a serious matter. It's a sign of a serious problem. Maybe the dog is about to die because something is really stressing it out. One of the reasons why dogs pant is because of anxiety and stress. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was highlighting here about this dog, that if you decide to give it work, it starts to pant. And if you leave it alone, it starts to pant. Why is Allah mentioning this example here? Because this person who abandons deen can never find rest in their lives anymore. There's no rest in their life anymore. How is it so? In front of the people, they are working hard. They are like put it to work, like Allah said, right? They worry about people being angry with them. So they work hard to put up an image or whatever image they're trying to do. So they try to please the people. In the dead of night, they are worried about the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're worried about Allah Ta'ala being upset at them because they know the deen is right. They know the deen is the truth. They have no doubt about that. So because of that though, they can't find any sleep anymore. They can't even enjoy their rest at home because now in one way they're angering people. Another way they're angering Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. So now I always, and SubhanAllah, this example, the dog in this surah is just so amazing to me. You know, like, because Allah said about shaitan that he is either following them or he makes them the leader, right? You know, he makes shaitan makes them follow him or he becomes a leader, whatever. And when you're looking at a person like walking a dog, you wonder who's the leader, right? Is it the dog or the owner? It's just amazing. And then SubhanAllah, where does the dog go at the end? He goes to take like a poop or something, right? He goes to use the bathroom, whatever. And that's literally what we're doing here when we're following shaitan. He's just going to make us look like straight up like jokes at the end. And that's what happens here. So SubhanAllah, this example is been given for this man called Bal'am. Bal'am ibn Ba'ura. Right? Bal'am, he was in the time of Bani Israel. Okay, so I want to mention just certain snippets of who it could have referred to. A pious slave during the time of Bani Israel, who was he? They said that he was so close to being a prophet, like he was almost like a prophet to his own people. His du'as are readily answered. Every single du'a he would make would be accepted. Okay, so Musa alayhi salam came to his land, came to his nation, whatever, with his people of Bani Israel. So what happens is Bal'am is called by his people, that the people were worried and said, oh Bal'am, this man, Musa, is going to take over our land. What you need to do is you need to make dua against him. Okay? So Bal'am says, okay, let me ask Allah. Let me see what Allah says about Musa alayhi salam and his people. So then Bal'am starts to make dua. Now what happens is every single time Bal'am makes dua to Allah, he gets this response from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh Bal'am, do not make dua against them. They are my slaves and they have their prophet. So in other words, Allah is telling him that you're going to have to follow this prophet too. Do not make bad-du'a. Do not make du'a against them, O Bal'am. So this was Allah's command to him. He got the sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then what happens is this, though, he goes back to his people and says, oh, so-and-so, Qawm, all my people, I asked Allah, and Allah told me, don't make dua against him. Right? And but the people are like, what are you talking about? He's going to come in and take our land. Bal'am, you have to. So they started to bribe him. They gave him gifts upon gifts upon gifts and told him, Bal'am, make dua against them. And so now Bal'am is being convinced by these gifts. And even though he's getting signs from Allah, that Allah is telling him, do not make bad dua against them. So what does Bal'am do? He began making dua. He began making dua. And now he's decided to slip out of the skin of humanity, slip out of the skin of what Allah gave him, and not follow the signs. So he'd make dua against Musa alayhi salam. Every time he would make dua against Musa, he raised his hands, and everyone is there in the community raising their hands with Bal'am. Bal'am would say the dua against Musa, and then when he would open his mouth to make the dua, he would instead say, may Allah give victory to Musa. He would try to make dua against Musa alayhi salam, but then he would make dua, and instead of saying, may Allah curse Musa, he would say, may Allah give victory to Musa. And his tongue would continuously make that dua. And the people would be like, hey, didn't we call you to make dua against Musa? What are you doing? And he said, I'm sorry. So then he tries again to make dua for his own people this time. And so in his mind, he's thinking, I want to say, Allah, help my people. But when he raises his hand, he says, may Allah destroy my people. And people are like, what are you doing, Bal'am? We gave you all this money and stuff so that way you would listen to us. What is this nonsense you're doing? So Bal'am would keep trying, and he'd try again. He would try so hard, ya Allah. And every single time he tried to make dua against Musa, ya Allah, help Musa, would keep coming out. Every time he tried to make dua for his people, ya Allah, destroy my people. He tried so hard. So what happened is what? He tried so hard, his tongue was yanked out from his mouth, and it drooped onto his chest, and he looked exactly like a dog. This is how Allah disgraced him. This is how Allah disgraced him. That you were given signs from Allah, and you could have followed the right way, but you decided to follow the dunya, decided to follow the people, and abandon my signs. Allah said, your example is like a dog. This is where the actual context of the story comes down on, and this man named Bal'am. But this is one way of interpreting it. Another man was the time of the Prophet ﷺ. His name was Umayyah ibn Abi Salt. He's a very salty guy. Okay? Allah knows. All right. So he had knowledge of many religions. Okay? And he knew about the deen of Islam. He knew about Ibrahim ﷺ's religion. He knew about Christianity. He knew about Judaism. But he got no benefit from this knowledge. Because why? Because when the Prophet ﷺ came out, and he knew he was the last prophet, he was so respected in the community. He didn't want to leave his position. He didn't want to leave his rank with the community. So what did he do? He said, no, this prophet's a liar. He's a sinner. He's a transgressor. Don't follow him. Okay, but it was clear to him. And the Prophet ﷺ often said it about him because Nabi ﷺ liked his poetry. And he said, Umayyah was such a great guy. You know, his tongue was a mu'min's tongue, but his heart was not a mu'min's heart. His tongue was a good heart. His tongue was a good tongue, but his heart was not a good heart. So he did not believe as well. So he was also given signs and he abandoned them. But what I want everyone to know is that the Prophet ﷺ, when he spoke about this, he made it very general. And I want everyone to look at it. That which I fear upon you is a man who reads the Quran. Until his glamour is seen, he sees how well respected he is in the community, and then he becomes the cloak of Islam. Then he decides to strip off the cloak to whatever Allah Ta'ala wills, and he slithers away from it. The same word Allah Ta'ala, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam uses, that Allah Ta'ala used, فَانْصَلَقَ مِنْهُ, right? He slithers away from it, and he throws it behind his back, and then he goes around fighting his neighbors and calls them mushriks, okay? What is the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam highlighting here? He's highlighting the problem, the issue with celebrity shuyukh, okay? Because why? Because a celebrity sheikh will have a certain bayan that people loved. And because of that, he became so famous in front of people. And admittedly so, mashallah, they have really good words to say. But what happens is what? It doesn't last for a very long time. So you got to make sure the fame lasts, you know? So what do you do? Do you know what? You became the cloak of Islam? Strip it off, right? Go ahead. Just take away Islam and start giving controversial opinions. You want to become even more famous? Start calling this group is a bid'ati, mubtadi'. Call these people mushriks. Call these people like this. Call them kafir. Look how fast you become famous on YouTube. Look how fast you get Twitter followers. Look how fast you become good on Facebook. Just give a controversial opinion. Go ahead. Allah Ta'ala is reminding us, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam reminding us, be careful. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, this is what I fear. And I remind everyone here listening, be careful about following the shuyukh like you worship them. Don't follow them like that. You worship Allah. Okay? This is a reminder to scholars and speakers, myself included, that fame is not the goal here. Fame is not the game here. The game is that we worship Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. The game is that we recognize Allah. That's the goal here. So we have to remember, inshallah, that there are certain people that will become famous, okay? Because they spoke some weird garbar controversy stuff, whatever. But that does not mean that they are right. They might have just abandoned Islam and said something weird in Islam so people would notice them and look at them. You know, if a guy is walking around again naked in front of everyone who's clothed, people will look at him, right? Or, you know, like, but it's not something to be proud of. So this is something that we're finding here. That people just want fame, so they give something really controversial so people can listen to them. May Allah save us from that. We're here to follow Islam, not to follow desires. Now, it's important, inshallah, the last thing that we'll mention is that It's important to shift this to the audience though. Okay, we've been gifted with this deen and signs. So we don't just say, oh, this is about Balaam, this is about Umayyah, and this is about the Prophet and about celebrity shuyukh or scholars, whatever. This is about you and I. Okay, because you and I are people that we might reject Allah Ta'ala's signs. Okay, and then we are oppressing ourselves, Allah Ta'ala says. This is the worst example. Sa'a masana al-qawm, this is the worst example. That we gave him our signs and they decided to reject them, they wronged themselves. And Allah Ta'ala says, look, مَا يَهْدِ اللَّهَ فَوَالْمُهْتَدِي وَمَا يُضْلِلْ فَأُولَٰئِكُمْ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Look, whoever Allah Ta'ala gave guidance, you are on the straight path. Don't follow anything else. Don't look at anything else, okay? This entire world is going crazy. Right now, it's in a straight pandemic. People don't know what to do. You, alhamdulillah, have guidance from Allah and the guidance from Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You know exactly what to do. You pray, you stay committed to your da'wah, you stay committed to your ibadah. Allah will give us guidance and light at the end of the tunnel, inshallah. But you and I need to stay committed, inshallah. Don't think there's anywhere else there's guidance. Allah says, this is where the guidance is. You stick to it. Don't abandon it. Don't go anywhere else. Don't tell yourself anything else. There's nothing else. You have the glass of water, the entire world is thirsty. You're not going to find water anywhere else in the world. You have the water to feed the people, inshallah. So why would you shift away from the truth when you know the truth is here? Don't get distracted. Don't get misguided. Don't look around. You know that, inshallah, this book has the truth in it. Trust in this book. And you know, inshallah, that the end will be the best. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, that the best end is for those who have taqwa, inshallah. We ask Allah for tawfiq and hidayah. We ask Allah that He guides us to the last moments, the last breath, inshallah. Wa bi kalimati la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.